a sunny as well as a rainy hello from Manila on site from the first International Solidarity Conference for the Rights of Climate Migrants. Right now we are in conversation with Sanila Sanu, who is head of the Pan-African Climate Justice Alliance. Welcome, Selina.
Thank you.
Selina, what is climate justice? You are heading a Climate Justice Alliance.
Climate justice is a lot of things. It's about poverty, because climate actually leads to poverty. It's not well taken care of. It is also about humanitarian, because it can lead to humanitarian crisis. It's also about equity, because as you've seen, climate has created a rift between countries and also between people. And it's also a political it's a political issue, because right now it is on the agenda of political conversations globally. As you know, when you look at the Paris Agreement or even the SDGs, climate plays a very major role in those frameworks and in the climate conversations at global level.
Are climate migrants survivors of climate injustice? I don't want to call them victims. Somehow the word victim does not suit. Maybe because they have survived that. So are climate migrants survivors of climate injustice?
Definitely. We are now starting to really link climate change to migrations. We are beginning to see actually that there is a nexus between climate and migrations. So therefore, yes, they are survivors of climate injustices.
What are the injustices which they are facing?
Some of the injustices they are facing is that the environmental degradation or climate change has led into the destruction of their livelihoods, either whether through floods, through droughts. They've gone through they've gone through these types of injustices. That is one. Secondly, they've been as a result of climate change and environmental degradation, they've been pushed out of the places of origin, and they are forced to look for better alternatives elsewhere. And that process alone of displacement puts them into a lot of difficulties, and that is another form of injustice. Then thirdly, where they arrive, the communities that where they go to, in most cases they are not friendly, and they lead to tensions and lead to conflict. That is another form of injustice for them.
Right now there's a lot of discuss going around climate migrants, or call them climate refugees. This conference is about beyond labels and beyond borders. So how does this labeling affect them? Does it affect their status or their rights, particularly maybe at the UN level?
Like I said yesterday in my presentation, I really do not care about the labeling. It shouldn't preoccupy us. I don't think the labeling is what we need to be discussing. I think it is the root causes of what made them to be labeled is what we need to be looking at. And frankly speaking, the labeling is a form of stigma. I don't think you want to go around calling yourself, oh, I came to your country because I am a climate migrant or climate refugee. I don't think that is I don't think those are very positive labels to give people. Yes.
And that is what this whole conference is about.
And this is why all this conference is about that. And I was very surprised, because I think we had passed beyond the labeling. I didn't think that it was still a discussion on the table. So that surprised me a bit to see that that's what we were discussing here. Yes.
What has been Africa's response to climate-induced migration?
Like I said also in the presentation, it is... our leaders have not been able to link climate change to migrations. Let's start from that. They have not been able to link that. So there hasn't been a response per se to the issue, because the issues are seen as two different parallel issues are not the same issues. But now we're beginning to look at that. Civil society like PACCHA and partners in the continent are really beginning now to scrutinize that and say, no, let us do more research to find out, to establish the nexus and to be able to lobby our policy makers and our leaders to say, if we do not address climate change, there is a strong relationship with migrations. Yes.
Can you share some specific examples about climate migration in any part of Africa or maybe from the place where you come?
There are many. Like I'm not very conversant with the statistics, but I think about 20% of our migration, of our migrants, or climate-induced migrants, go to outside the continent, either to Europe or the Middle East, the Gulf. 80% is within the continent, moving across borders from country to country. So, and there are very clear examples. The recent xenophobia in South Africa is a clear example of migrants that have left their countries from Nigeria, from Somalia, from the frontline states in Southern Africa like Mozambique, Zimbabwe, that find themselves in South Africa, have moved there as a result of climate-induced migrations. And that is that is why the consequences are xenophobia, because the host communities are threatened and they feel that the migrants have come to take their livelihoods, to take their positions, and they feel that they are being squeezed out of their spaces within their own country. Yes.
So, what is the way forward, according to you? What would be sustainable solutions?
Well, if we can address climate change in our countries to keep people in the countries and create employment, like green jobs for our youth, that would be the first thing to start with. However, in cases where there are migrations, because that you cannot also control, I think that countries, if I take the African continent, for example, I think member states need to really sit and talk within the African Union to see how can they bring about the issues of migrants within their integration framework, to allow safe passages, to provide security and provide opportunities for migrants. Yeah.
Take-home message from this conference, any of your key learnings from this conference, and then your message for others.
Yeah, I think that from this conference there was a lot of discussions that were very beneficial to all of us. I think we were able to exchange. We've seen countries that are really at the forefront that have gone through so much in terms of climate-induced migrations, like the Philippines. I think the Philippines is a place to really learn from. I'm sure your own country, India, there is a lot to learn from. Then there are those that are getting into this conversation that need to learn also from this. So it was a very good platform for exchanges. For me, it was even more fruitful because I had to go outside Manila, visit a province where there are people who are at the forefront of climate change, who are now suffering from eviction on top of the climate injustices. So that for me also was something to take home. The message I'm giving to the world is that we need solidarity. We need a global solidarity around the issues of climate-induced migrations. We need to support the migrants and we need to give them a decent, dignified life.
Thank you, Sanila. And we were listening to Sanila Sanu, head of the Pan-African Climate Justice Alliance.
Head
of programs at Pan-African Climate Justice Alliance. And on site from the first International Solidarity Conference for climate migrants being held in Manila and organized by Rosa Luxemburg Stiftung. Thank you, friends.
Thank you.